So my name is Eric Gelinas. I'm a front-end engineer at Flickr, and we're going to talk maps. So about 2 years ago, Flickr redesigned our most highly trafficked site. And what we were hoping to do was improve some of the performance of it, and we also wanted to kind of reassess everything that we put on the page and see if there's some things we should put on there, see if there's some things we should take off of there. And this is what we ended up with. And you'll notice that after all of that, we decided we're going to put a map on there. And we asked ourselves, so do we really need a map? Thinking about why Flickr uses maps, we came up with these reasons. Flickr uses maps, one, for navigation, and two, to tell a story. So getting into the navigation part, there are a lot of photos on Flickr. As you can see, we have some cats on there. And once you use one of our maps to kind of navigate all of those photos, you can do things like this. If I was going to take a trip to Palermo, and this is actually something I'm planning on doing, I can go to Palermo on the map, I can look for all of these photos in there and kind of build out my, what I would want to do on my vacation, looking at all these photos. Another reason that we use maps on Flickr is to tell a story. And so, if you came across this photo on Flickr, you would think that it's a nice photo, you'd wonder what it's all about, but on our photo page that we've recently redesigned, you can see that this was taken in Cairo on February 19th, which means that it's part of the Egyptian Revolution. It makes it a little bit more interesting, so you don't have to dig into this photo too much, you can kind of see exactly what it's about pretty quickly. So that's what we ended up with. This is our new photo page with the map on it. And now looking at the types of people that will be looking at this map, we wanted to try to figure out how to make it as useful for the different people that'll come on here as possible. We figured that those different people are going to be your contacts who will come across your photo page. And they probably know a lot about where you're from, where you take your photos most often. If you've taken a vacation, they probably know where you went. But over time, hopefully, there's going to be more explorers that hit your photo. People who search for it on the internet, looking for whatever, they search Google and they find your photo. Those are going to end up being a lot of people, and they may not know exactly where you live. So what we decided to do was have these three different levels of zoom that are available on our photo page. The first level is very far zoomed out, and it gives you an idea of where in the world that photo was taken. When you hover over the photo, then you see something that's a little bit further zoomed in, gives you an idea of what the city looks like, and then when you hover over the dot in the middle, you get the furthest zoomed in, which is the actual neighborhood that that photo was taken. So that third zoom is probably more useful for your friends, and the explorers that come to your page will get to kind of slowly come down and get an idea of where that photo was taken, the streets around it and stuff like that, after they've been familiarized with where it is in the globe. And so here's kind of an idea of how we did that using an open map provider. Right now, MapQuest provides open static maps. So if you wanted to do this yourself, I've put a gist on GitHub, which has a basic, simple example of how we did that. Feel free to take a look at it and play around with it. Basically, as you can see, we just changed the zoom level on hover, and there's more of an example in that gist. So another thing is we wanted to be really careful how this map worked and how it blended in with Flickr. I think a lot of map interfaces that I've seen look kind of awkward. I think we do kind of a good job of blending them in with our site. And I think the reason that some of them look awkward is because people rely on defaults. I think maps are very complicated. People kind of like the fact that they're a black box. You can just put them on there, give it a latitude and longitude, and it shows up and it works. But that doesn't blend in with your site very well. And this is something that's kind of personal to me. I used to live in Los Angeles, and I think that Metro has a great site for, getting directions, places, using the subway and things like that in LA. But the map always kind of frustrated me because, you put in your beginning place and the last and the, end location, and all you end up with is this place mark at the end. There's no kind of line drawn between the two points or anything like that. It's just kind of like, here's the end spot. And it's this default Google map. This is another problem. A lot of map tiles are just kind of cluttered with just about everything you could possibly want, all this geodata, including the stuff that you're looking for, but also including a lot of stuff you may not need. And this is an example of, I think, a really well-integrated map. This one is, they've actually built their own OpenStreetMaps implementation. This is StreetEasy. If you go to the OpenStreetMaps site, openstreetmaps.org, there's actually a case study from them on building their maps. But what they did was they reduced the amount of things that, the amount of data that was made to use their tiles. You can see that they're using the same iconography from the rest of the site. It looks very much like their site, and it blends in with it really well. So this is an example of something that's not awkward, that's very nice, and it fits with the rest of the site. So the next thing is slippy maps. So far, I've shown you static maps, which are just images of maps on a page. The next thing is these, you know, maps that are, you know, made using JavaScript, and you can move them around, and they're interactive. These are three popular map providers that will give you a black box that you can just, you know, put on your site and give it a latitude and longitude and pretty much have a map working. And we use one similar to this. And these are some methods that I've found in those that would let you kind of go into those black box maps and be able to customize them, be able to make them look more like your site. These aren't obviously the exact method names because they're different for each map provider, but these are the things I've found useful, and they seem to be available in all of these map providers. And these are some events also that I've found in those that help you kind of hook in and figure out how to make things work. One example would be, you know, with the methods, if you want to try to find out, you know, what the XY coordinates that you want to put an item on the map is, you can find that by giving a latitude and longitude, and then there are methods that'll give you back an XY coordinate where you can put that UI element. And then here you'll have a pan event that'll fire and kind of keep that element in line with, you know, where the user is panning. One thing that I did find out, though, is using Bing Maps, that pan event is a little off sync with the animations, and so your UI elements might trace behind it. I haven't really found a way around that yet, but it seems like the other two map providers are perfectly synced with that, and I've been able to use them. One event that I always end up kind of reproducing in all of these different map or producing for myself in these map providers is focus visibility change, which basically means usually you're going to put your map elements in a specific spot on the globe, and when you pan away from that, they'll just kind of keep going, you know, off the screen. So it's nice to know when the center that you, what you consider to be the center of the map, has moved off of the screen, and then you can kind of destroy all of those UI elements and all of the events that you have, kind of keeping them in line with the map. Just a little way of making performance better on the map. So when we were done with all of that, we ended up with this, which is the slippy map or the interactive map that we have on Flickr, which I think looks a lot like Flickr. It you know, feels common to anybody who uses it regularly. You can see our buttons are the same as the buttons that you have on the site. It just fits in really well. So that all being said, we wrote a lot of code to make that work that way. And since doing that, Mapstraction has come along, which is an interesting looking API. I haven't worked with it very closely, but it looks like it does a lot of the things that we kind of had to write ourselves. So what it'll do is let you code against their API, and then they kind of abstract out all of the things that the individual map providers do. So you could switch to Google or Bing or OV Maps or your own OpenStreetMaps implementation. So it gets a lot of that, and it also lets you customize the maps a lot of the same way that I was able to do that we were able to do with the Flickr map. So that'll be said when we, you know, put more location on Flickr and put the maps more prominent. We were hoping to get more location information from people for those stories and for the navigation. But location information is sensitive, and we have to make people feel more comfortable about putting their photos on Flickr. The way that we decided to solve that problem is to make geofences available. What this is an area that you can draw, a circle that you can draw in certain places, and I think we can there's a certain amount of circles that you can draw. Which would be like a place, you draw a circle around your house or your office or maybe a whole city and say that if photos are taken in this area, I want to restrict the permissions of who could see where this photo was taken. And you know, once we put this on there, it makes people feel a lot more comfortable. They can put a big circle over their house and say, okay, I'm going to take pictures all over the place, and all of those go up on Flickr, but these, if they're taken in my home, I only want my family to see them, or I want to be the only one who sees them. And so that way, you know, it helps us get more geo information and makes the map more interesting. So that's where Flickr is right now with maps. But there's a lot of interesting things happening right now in the area of maps. One of the things that's kind of causing this, I think, is Google started charging for their map API if you start to use it enough. And that's caused a lot of people to want to kind of figure out other options. And I think OpenStreetMaps has picked up a lot on that. People have learned that you can use OpenStreetMaps, which, if you're not familiar with that, is kind of like a it's kind of like Wikipedia for locations. Somebody can take a GPS trace or you know other ways that they can pull together map information and put it into OpenStreetMaps. And it's managed by lots of people, much like Wikipedia, and it's actually very accurate and has a lot of the globe mapped out. And certain things that you wouldn't get from a commercial map provider, like maybe a trail that's you know an obscure trail somewhere, they may have mapped it out for you. So it's really interesting, and a lot of people are taking these and kind of building their own map providers, much like you know Google and stuff like that, kind of homebrewing them. But doing that is complicated, and this is a little sample of the code that it takes to generate a tile. You can style them, and for a long time, you know, there's a lot of tools out there that'll help you to do it, but it's you know there's a steep learning curve in learning how to take this you know the geo data that you get from OpenStreetMaps and then generate a tile using this tool called Mapnik. And this is what they call a, you know, the Mapnik, this is the data that you give to Mapnik to tell it what the tile should look like. But recently, because of all of this kind of building of the community around OpenStreetMaps, this has been turned into this because there's a couple tools like this, but tile mills come along to basically give you a UI for this sort of thing. And so, what this does is it takes the use case of somebody trying to build maps for their site, and it puts a UI on that. It allows you to not have to answer all of these questions about, you know, are you trying to build a map for this? Do you need this projection? Do you need this? Usually, if you're building a map for a website, you know, all of those questions can be answered in that just being your use case. And they let you have this very simple interface for styling your map and for generating your map tiles, which go into that slippy map, that JavaScript map, or static maps. Inside of this also is something pretty awesome called Carto, which is a CSS style language, which you know it basically lets you map the or style these map tiles like you would with CSS. Also, this tool, it kind of reminds me of back when we all got Firebug. You know, when we were able to suddenly you know make changes to the CSS while we're looking at the web page and not have to refresh the page to see our changes. Suddenly now you can maybe change the color of the water and then hit save, and suddenly you see map tiles that are that color. And so it's doing all of that work that you see here, but it's kind of doing it all for you. And you know, there's still kind of a learning curve with some of the data stuff, but when it comes to styling it, it's become a lot easier. And these, you know, so these tools I really think are gonna, you know, pretty soon get people to start putting maps on their sites that you know, we no longer have to say that, you know, if it's not important to you, you don't need to know where all of the fire departments are in an area. Maybe you just want to show streets. Maybe you don't need to show, you know, which parcels of land are around because that's not interesting to your website. I think people end up with websites or with maps on their websites that fit in a lot better and have just the data that they need. So if you're interested in looking more into this OSM stuff and maybe, you know, putting it on your website, generating your own tiles, there's lots of information. Also, you know, there's companies out there who have already got the tiles generated and host them for you. There's lots of stuff here. So take a look at switchtoosm.org. It's some interesting stuff. And as far as geo on Flickr, it's got a long history. There's a lot of blog posts on there. I'm you know, working with the product of a lot of people who've done a lot of work. So if you're interested in geo, please take a look at our blog code.flickr.com. /blog/tag/geo. And I thank you. There's some links here. Please take down some of those and have a look. Thank you.